All right. Hey, I want you to know something. It's Father's Day. We're in a sermon series called When the Fight Calls. How many of you enjoyed that a little bit? Anybody enjoyed that?
Yeah.
You've been here before, last week or two, and talking about the journey of the God's people in the Old Testament. The story about Moses, and we got people out of Egypt. They wandered through the desert, and now they're getting up to the Jordan River, and they're about ready to cross over, but Moses doesn't get to take them across. He hands the baton off, and Joshua, young man, is going to be the one to take them across. And everywhere that they go across the river, even though it's the promised land, it's going to be a fight, right? And everybody knows, come on, life is going to be a fight sometimes, even for the good things God has for you. It's a good place to say amen. Right? So Joshua's going to do that. So that's the name of our series, When the Fight Calls. And today I want to, I don't always do this, but I want to dedicate this message to my kids because it's Father's Day. And they're, I think Austin's, I don't know where Austin is. I think he's trying to see if there's signal to find out about the game. I'm not going to lie. I don't know. No, he's probably helping somewhere. And my kid's been here all day helping out. Abby's helping somewhere. I also want to dedicate it to my dad. And my dad and my mom drove up from Portland for the weekend to be with us for Father's Day. Aren't they great? That's so cute. That's the relationship goals right there. And my kids, come on, my kids bought me some new kicks for Father's Day. Man, I feel good. I'm like, whoa, woo. It's going to be good. It's going to be a good message. Good shoes, good message. I think that's, I don't know if that's in the Bible, but let's just go. I want to share with you, we're going to jump into the story of Joshua in just a moment. I want to read you one other scripture in the Bible. And here's what I'm going to do today. I'm going to share with you about one specific thing. God has a heart like a father, a good father for his people. And I want to talk to you about God's father heart today, what that means for you and me, and how it comes out in this message. But I want you to know that anytime in church, you know, if somebody ever talks about God the Father, the father heart of God, I know that for some people they can immediately shut down and go, man, I had a bad childhood, or dad left, or my mom and dad got shifted around, and you don't know my story. I get that, but I want to just ask something here tonight. As we dive into this, regardless of what your experience has been, and man, I'm telling you, I talked to enough people to know everybody's had some struggles in life growing up. But regardless of your experiences, I'm going to ask that you just open your heart to the message tonight, to the preaching of the gospel and the word, and that you just go, man, God, if you got something to say to me tonight, I need to hear that today. And so if you're willing to just open your heart, would you just give me one more amen tonight as we start? I think God wants to speak to us about his heart. All right, well, here we go. The first verse I want to read to you is King David. He writes about God's character. And here's what he says. He says, Father to the fatherless and defender of widows. This is God. His dwelling or his house, it's holy. And God places the lonely in families. And he sets the prisoners free. And he gives them joy. And man, David's writing this. He's talking about, what is God like? And he says, this is God. He's a father to the fatherless. And I can tell you, I've heard enough stories to know about people who've grown up, maybe their dad died, or there was a divorce, or abuse, or I've heard somebody in the last 2 months tell me a story about how they had to go into witness protection program and run away from their father who was trying to hunt them down. I've heard some of the most horrific things, but I want you to know this, that God's character, he is a father for those who do not have a father. And his house is holy, meaning it's single focus to be a loving place. Like, God is there for people like that. And I'm thankful for this church, and some of you become my friends, and some of you maybe have been lonely, and God put you in this house, and brought you into this church, and gave you a friend, gave you a mentor, a brother, somebody to stand with you and pray for you. Come on, God puts lonely people inside a family. And sometimes when we're hurt in a family, that's the last thing we want to go back into. But the reality is that when you get hurt in a family situation, sometimes the healing comes in a family situation.
Amen.
And God does that. He restores us. He heals us up. And this is the character of God. Now, having set that stage, I want to show you Joshua and the story we're going to preach on tonight. It's related to that. But here we go. After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua. After the death of Moses, the Lord speaks. Let me just say this, that man, I've noticed before we go any further in this message and in this scripture, I've noticed that in life, oftentimes when you go through a very rough patch, it's in those dark moments, it's in that down and out, rock bottom time, it's in those moments when God begins to speak to you. And sometimes you go, man, I can't take anymore. You get punched one more time, and you just feel like, I'm done. I don't know what I can do. But I'm telling you, it's at those moments that God will reach out to you, and God will speak to you. And sometimes it's at the crest of what seems like utter devastation, but God's about to swoop in and carry you through and speak to you and give you guidance for the rest of your life and for the next phase of your life. And it's this way for Joshua. You need to know that in the story we're reading the scripture from, that they had gone this whole distance, all God's people. They got out of Egypt together. They go through 40 years walking through the desert together, and a lot of the older folks that died off, but they're now ready to go in, and Moses has been their leader for the whole time. The first five books of the Bible are written by Moses. The whole nation's looking at Moses as God's man, God's servant, the prophet of God, the one who is literally writing the scriptures at that time, and here he is, and they're ready to go into all that God has for their destiny, and Moses dies. And it's at that moment that God raises Joshua up. And this is what happens right here, is that God speaks to Joshua in Joshua's moment of devastation. This is what God says. Captain Obvious, God says, Moses, my servant, is dead. As if Joshua didn't know that. But you know what I found sometimes is that, and you might be in a scenario in your life, regardless of what that is, but when God speaks to you about a scenario in your life, it just solidifies it. Makes it like settles it in your guts, in your heart. And you go, man, God goes, it's time to move on. It's time for this thing. You've been through a lot. And you go, yeah, you're telling me. But when God speaks, if there's something that settles in your spirit, it goes, man, God, you see and you know what I'm going through. And God speaks that way to Joshua and says, Moses, my servant is dead. Then he goes on to tell Joshua, now it's your turn to lead. It's time for you to stand up and lead these people into the promised land. Man, this is where I want to go tonight with this message, is tell you that regardless of what's happened in your past, no matter who's died, abandoned you, left you, you're at the edge of your destiny, but you feel like you're just all by yourself, I want you to know God is saying to you tonight, the past is the past, but your time to lead and go forward is right now. It's time for you to step into what God has for you for the future and stop worrying about the past and start stepping in to the good land that God has for you. Get into that fight. Quit fighting off bad memories about the past and start fighting the real battles for the people that are going to come after you, that are looking to you for leadership.
Amen.
And just be ready to go and get in the ring.
Yeah.
Come on, lace up the gloves and come on, do a little dance. You know, be athletic just like me. And to fight. Moses, my servant is dead. The time has come for you to lead. Lead these people. I won't fail. I won't abandon you. This is a beautiful thing about God's promise. When God speaks to you, God always will reassure you. No matter how devastated you are, no matter what you've gone through, God's promise is secure. I am with you. I won't fail you. I won't abandon you. And even if Moses in your life dies, I'm God. I can't die. I'm going to stay with you. I'm telling you, you gotta put your anchors into the spiritual world and hang on to God in life. Because He's faithful. He's always there for us. Alright, well, let's break into this a little bit. God's a good Father and cares for people who've been through it, don't have a father figure in their life, cares about people on their own, people that are alone, people that are struggling. He cares about those people. God's a father to the fatherless. Amen. But I want to go a step further tonight. This is the message God put in my heart for tonight. Is that although God is a father to the fatherless are going to become the next generation of fathers and mothers. And so it's time for you to step in and lead. God is going to take you, regardless of what your life has been like, and He's challenging you and me to step into what God has for us. Time for us to step in and lead. Man, I know some people can't tell good stories about the dad, but I can. My dad was a great dad for me, and you know, he's sitting here tonight, we were reminiscing about different memories, and one of the memories I have as a kid is my dad, I worked with my dad during the summers, and when I was a kid, video game machines, they were taller than you, they were massive, they were not, you know, a PSP you could put in your purse, or they weren't on your phone, you had to go to the machine wasn't with you, you had to put quarters in the machine. Anybody remember these? Popping the quarters in, and man, it was awesome. And so my dad, I'm at that age when this is a big deal, you know, quarters of video games. And my dad says, hey, We got to go to Uncle Willie's house. My dad was kind of the property manager. It was a little fourplex, like apartment thing. And it had its own little washing machine room. So it had a washing machine and a dryer. The washing machine and the dryer, like most apartments, you got to put the quarters in to make it work. And it was clogged up. There were so many quarters, we had to get in there and clean out the quarters. And my dad says, you want to go help me? I'm like, yeah. So I go to my dad and we get in there. I've never seen how it was done. He takes all the screws off the back panel, reaches in there, undoes a little thing, pulls out this chest of treasure filled with quarters. And I'm like, woohoo! And he dumps it into a canvas bag, you know, and pulls it, you know, like Santa Claus, and just all these quarters. And I'm like, wow, this is awesome. Remember, we get in the truck to leave, and my dad's sitting there driving, and then in the middle there by the stick shift is this big bag of quarters, and then I'm sitting there as a young teenager looking at that bag of quarters going, wow, you know. And my dad says this, he says, would you like a few quarters? I said, yes, I would. He said, okay. I said, how many can I have? He goes, one handful. I said, do you care how big of a scoop I get? He goes, no, as big a scoop as you can get. Go for it. I said, as big a scoop as I can get, you know, I'm making this deal. And he says, yeah, as much as you can get in one handful, go for it. I stuck my hand strategically into that bag, got my hand at the bottom, lifted it up, you know, sorting them as I can, and dumping them onto my forearm, and just with a heave, as many quarters out onto my lap as possible. And I'm like, woo! I count, my dad's laughing, I'm counting up all the quarters. I got $78 worth of quarters in my lap that day. That was the greatest day of my life. Except for when I got married and had kids, whatever. You're gonna get real, right? Okay, so I get all those quarters, and man, I couldn't believe it. The funny thing is, I didn't even hardly touch that bag. There was so many quarters in the bag, but it was just great that my dad was just giving to me. I want to just tell you this. What if God, your Father in heaven, has a sack of quarters bigger than you can carry, and he's saying, I want you to just stick your hand in and get as much of me as you want, as much as you can get. I got enough supply for you, and I'm going to bless you and let you take as much of me as you want. I'm telling you, God is like that. He wants to bless you. He is not holding out on you. He's a good dad. He'll give you as much of himself as you can take. In this story, you know, Joshua's at the edge of the river. They're getting ready to cross over. And I know I've been preaching out of Joshua chapter 1 for 3 weeks now, but we're going to cross the river soon. Just stay with me. But let me just tell you, some of this stuff is echoed in my heart. Moses is dead. Man, I'm telling you that right before a great victory, it seems like, there's always a great challenge. Always in life. I don't know if you can experience that. You got to live a little while, and you'll look back and see before every great victory, there's a great challenge. And here it is that Moses is dead. Moses, in this story, is a real figure. But for Joshua, Moses represented the generation before him. And for you and me tonight, your Moses is the parents and the leaders that came before you. And maybe they're gone, maybe they're not there. And God, when he speaks to us, he says, Moses is dead. God's setting you up to get the reality in your heart that he's going to move you forward. Moses is dead. You know, I think about so many young people that I've met over the years that didn't grow up with a great family scenario, with a mom or a dad gone off the deep end or just absent, all kinds of different stories, like I said before, but it's just kind of a common thread. And you don't see a lot of white picket fences and mom and dad sticking together. My parents living together, married for 50 years, is an anomaly. It's an anomaly because that doesn't happen that much anymore. And I recognize that. Some of us in this room have experienced some of that in our own lives. And there's no guilt or shame in this message, but this is a reality that people are growing up and they don't have that. Remember, we had I've been a youth pastor for 19 years, a pastor here for 6 years, volunteered junior high pastor in Portland for 7 years. I mean, I've been working with young people for a long time. You've seen a lot of pain. You see young people, they look like they're all right on the outside. They got their cool jeans on, their cool red shoes, they got the rips just in the right places. They pay extra for those, just so you know. And, you know, come on, they look all right. But on the inside, they might be broken down because of what they've been through. And I had somebody come to our door one time. We were youth pastors of this family in our church, and family kind of blew up. And it was back in Vancouver. And I'm going to call this girl Wendy. It's not her real name. And it was, if I remember right, it was a Thursday or Friday night, and Wendy shows up at our door really late at night, knocking on the door. It was raining. But that's obvious because it was Vancouver, Washington. It always rained. But it was raining. She was all wet, didn't have a coat. And we hadn't seen her in about a year in our youth ministry. And I said, Wendy, what's going on? And she said, I'm in a real bad spot. I'm wondering if I could come in. I didn't know who else to call. I said, yeah, Wendy, come on in. She begins to tell us a story. She starts crying. And this poor girl, she said, you know, I got kicked out of my parents' house because it wasn't a good scenario. We were fighting. I said, yeah, I had heard about that. She ended up moving in with her older sister. And her older sister had a studio apartment with four people living there, plus her sister, in a studio apartment. And she said, Pastor Matt, I wake up every morning to a cloud of marijuana smoke. And I don't want to do drugs. I'm trying to get out of that, but I just want you to know that I can't. It's just in there, and it's killing me, and there's all kinds of bad things happening in there. And I said something about it to my sister. My sister kicked me out, locked the door, wouldn't give me any of my stuff. She goes, and I just got kicked out of school this week. She was a senior, 3 months left to graduate. I got kicked out of school, and I lost my job. I mean, I'm telling you, the only thing that could have been worse is if she said, and the Golden State lost. You know, that would be the only, I'm just kidding. All right, now listen, this is her real life. And she said, I didn't know where to go. And I said, hey, all right. I said, why don't you stay with us for a couple nights? She goes, man, I haven't been to church. I said, it doesn't matter. Well, we hugged her, prayed for her. I said, are you hungry, Wendy? She said, I am hungry. Sat that girl down at the table, had leftovers, gave her some food. That girl ate. Ladies, come on, you act like, I'm telling you, some of you ladies can throw it down. You are, I don't know, when you're, come on, you're just like, when nobody's looking, you're like, oh, man, come on. Listen, this girl could eat, man. And she ate 2.5 plates of food. She hadn't eaten in a long time. We snuck, one of us went off to Walmart, we bought her a candle for her room, we bought her some fresh clothes. She didn't have anything to change into. We bought her some shampoo and some conditioner, we put a Bible in her room. We just moved Abigail out of Abby's little room. She was little, put her in with us, and we said, hey, Wendy, you can have this room. And we just made a place for her, and she just broke down crying. She said, I don't know why. I said, because God has done some good for us. He's been a good father for us. I just want to show you God's love in a real tangible way. And she lived in our house for a little while until she got back on her feet. I want you to know that young people sometimes go through a mess in life. They look good on the outside, but you have no idea the pain. And they need somebody to step up and lead them and be a mother and a father to them. And you might not go, I don't have much experience in that. I'm telling you that God's calling you to lead right now somebody that's coming behind you.
Amen.
People are in need. Just think about our interns. That we just graduated at the end of May, and I think I got a picture of them. It's a great group of people. Look at those guys. Oh my gosh. It's like Christ City's had a good looking contest, and the top 20 went to the interns right there.
Yes, sir.
Wonderful. And you look at these kids, they look so great. This is on the last night in May, but back in September, we had their opening retreat. We got all these kids together. We're down in the Hood River area, we're having some pizza, and we're having the kids go around while we're waiting for the pizza and just share their stories, a little bit about their life. And one after the other, not all of them, some of them have some pretty stable homes, but the majority of them are sharing how didn't have mom or dad there, and for them that's just a bygone thing. They just know it's just part of their story, and they're surviving, they're moving on, and they're going around the story, and I'm sitting there with pizza in front of me, breaking down, almost starting to cry on my pizza. And I elbowed Lisa, I said, none of these kids have a stable home. I said, we need to pray that God helps these kids, establishes them, heals them up. I was just heartbroken that night hearing these stories, but they're just like survivors and strong, and God's already moving in their life. The one kid on the top right there, Nick Eddy, great young man, came to our church. He had a lifestyle of doing a lot of different drugs and a lot of just different bad stuff in his life. Got invited to our church, and God began to change him. He signed up to do the internship, and we videotaped his story, and I want you to just hear his own words, what God did in his life.
So growing up, Father's Day was always kind of a hard day for me. Throughout most of my life, I grew up with an abusive father, and then a mostly absent father. When I was a baby, my parents got divorced. I split time at my parents' houses and spent about every other weekend at my dad's. I didn't grow up with the best father. One of the biggest memories, one of the biggest wounds I have in my life is that if my sports games were on his visitation time, he'd take me out of them and make me watch them. Yeah, so I didn't really, never liked my father. Never liked Father's Day because I didn't support it. And about 2 years ago, I started coming to this church, started coming to Gravity, met a few leaders that were great fathers, met a few just great men, people that influenced me. I think the biggest fear I've ever had in my life is that I would grow up and be a bad father. So at the start of this last year's internship, the first day we were supposed to write what God was going to do in our lives. And I was praying, and God told me that He's going to make me into the father that I never had. At the start of the year, I was asked to teach the elementary kids, take over as a lead teacher. And I was scared, because I didn't think I had the ability or anything. I didn't think I could communicate well with them. I didn't think I could lead kids. Love kids, be impactful and all. And then what's funny is Ray was asked to teach with me. It was me and Ray in the same class. None of us, both of us, grew up with absent fathers. It's just funny because now Joe's tuned in with absent fathers to teach and lead kids in the church. And so these last 2 years has been, father figures pouring into my life, being able to lead kids, and it's really made me confident that I'll be a good father in the future.
Tell you, Nick's a great young man. God's gonna take the fatherless, and Nick Eddie's little sprouts, and make them the leaders for the next generation, because God can do that.
Come on.
He's a good man. Some of you haven't had a father. Some of you had a bad father. The devastation of it can keep us from believing that we can lean into the future. But in God, miracles, even in the deepest places of our hearts, miracles find those places we have to move. Because God is a miracle-working God. I have one other video I wanted to show you. I saw this a couple months back and it just wrecked me. So I thought I'd just wreck you all. But it's a powerful statement about how God can turn our lives around. And it's the story of Kelly Clarkson, the first American Idol winner. And she got fame and fortune, but her dad had abandoned her at a young age. And she had kind of written off the fact that there could be a good man that would come into her life. I want you to know that, come on, in the kingdom of God, there's some good men.
Yes.
Not all men are bad. We're not perfect, but I'll tell you what, God's changing men, making them into men of God, and men like Jesus. That's what we hope to be. But she got married, and it was her husband who showed her that, man, there could be a good father in her life. And I think this will minister to you.
A very emotional song called Peace by Peace. Please welcome Kelly Clarkson. Thank you.
She won't know. Yeah, I realize we got all kinds of scenarios in this room. And maybe you're a dad and you haven't been perfect. I certainly haven't had moments I've had to sit down in front of my kids and apologize to them. But this is not about guilt. This is about God's Spirit's here to heal some people tonight, right? I said to God's Spirit, because He's a good Father, peace by peace, healing some hearts in here tonight. Doing some good. And healing up some souls so we can lead the next generation. Come on, I know it's painful, but Moses is dead. What happened in the past, it happened. It's gone. We can't go back and fix that. And God's bringing us to the edge of our destiny and saying, it's time, with all you've been through, to step into the water, step across, and lead. Because people are leaning on you. People are looking at you. They're watching you. They need you to make it. They need you to make some good choices and change the destiny of your family tree. And change what has happened for you. You know, hardship can set you up to be completely devastated or completely devoted. So the people who are most devoted to God, it's because they lost everything, but they hang on to the promise that God's a good Father. That God has promises, and in that complete devotion, it begins to rebuild the complete devastation in their life. C.S. Lewis, great Christian author, said this. He said, hardships often prepare ordinary people for an extraordinary destiny. I believe that about Nick Eddy, every one of those interns, every one of next year's interns, and everybody sitting in this room. And whatever you've been through, it was God's going to turn that around for His good, because He can do it. That's how He is. It's time for you to lead these people. You know, I love that in the middle of this emotional moment that God is having with Joshua on the bridge of his destiny, God makes His promise and says, I'm not going to abandon you. I won't fail you. I'll be with you. And if you read that story, it goes on several times to say, it's like God saying, young man, be strong and courageous. Keep going. I'm going to carry you through. I'm going to be your strength and your sword and your shield. Come on, God is for His kids. And it's just incredible. If we fast forward, because Joshua was so many years ago, you fast forward to the Jesus time frame that's in the Bible, 2,000 years behind us. And Jesus is laying His life down and doing what He can do for people. And He's hung on the cross and murdered for our benefits so that all the anger and the wrong that's in the world, all the punishment that we probably deserve because we contributed to it, Jesus takes that on the cross in our place, is raised to new life, and resurrected from the dead, and then God the Father brings Him back up to heaven, and Jesus commissioned His people to go start churches. Well, it was in that first decade or so that a man who had been killing Christians, his name was Paul, he hated God's movement of the Jesus people, and Paul had been killing Christians, but Paul encounters Jesus, and it changed Paul's life. And Paul gets converted and starts following Jesus instead of killing the Jesus church people. But how would you like to have that guy as your pastor? I don't know if I'd trust him, you know, especially if he had a concealed weapons permit. He's like, no, really, I'm not going to kill you, you know. But here, Paul is preaching now in the churches. And he writes letters to the churches that he helped start. And he captures something in that time frame about God's heart for people. And I want you to see what he wrote to the church in Rome. This is so great. He says, you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Come on, that's what we're saying tonight. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Instead, you received God's Spirit when He adopted you as His own children. Now we call Him Abba Father, which means dear Father. For His Spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. And since we're God's children, we are His heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we're heirs of God's glory. Your inheritance, your promised land to come, is everything that God has. And you have the same rights that Jesus had when you become His children. And you know what's great about adoption? Adoption is this. An adopted kid doesn't get to pick their parents. The parent picks the kid. And you know what? God adopted each and every one of us. It wasn't based on how good looking we were, if we could run fast or shoot a basketball, or how good of a kid you were going to be. God just chose you because he looks down and goes, I want you. I'm choosing you. I'm going to adopt you. I'm going to give you my family name. You're going to be my kid. This is the heart of God who chose us. So awesome. Man, you know, I've had a benefit in my life that not everybody's had. Like I was saying at the beginning, with having a mom and dad at home and a dad who was a good father for me. But I want to tell you a little story about that, because it almost wasn't that way. My dad grew up with a very verbally abusive father, very angry father. My granddad was not a kind man. My great-granddad I never met, but was even worse than that. And it went on for generations before that. Anger, you know, yelling, and all that kind of stuff. My dad would tell me stories about them growing up and the things that my granddad would do to my dad. Things like, waking up in the morning and my dad would call on the phone and just cuss him out for no reason first thing in the morning. I'd just like to make that up to that phone call from your dad. This is before you could block somebody out with a caller ID. And then my dad said that his dad never said thank you to him, ever, not one time. Never said I love you to my dad, unless my dad would grab my grandpa with me. I'd go, grandpa or dad, you know, I love you. And then my granddad would struggle to say it back. But he grows up with this, and one time my granddad took my dad's brother and threw him in the wild boar pit for punishment, because he was angry at him. And just all kinds of crazy stuff. I can tell you several stories. One of them is that my granddad stole the family inheritance from my dad and his brother and his sister. My great-granddad, when he died, left an inheritance for his kids, but also for the grandkids, which would have been my dad. But my grandpa took the money and the letters from the courthouse and got them redirected to his house. And he took care of the properties that were involved in all that for 7 years, so that at the end of the 7 years, by law, nobody's claimed that land, and you took care of it, you could claim it, and he did that. My dad found out about it about a month or 2 months too late, but he was taking care of his dad's house while my granddad's on vacation. He's collecting the mail, and he sees a letter with his own name, but going to granddad's house, opens up and finds out that granddad has stolen his inheritance. What kind of father is that? My dad grows up in that environment. My dad tells a story about when he goes to high school, my dad loves telling this story, how he got in a fight almost every week. And he said, you know, once you start winning a fight, then everybody wants to fight you, and then kids from other schools. And this is why my dad loves the story, because he goes, I never lost. And my dad was a good fighter. He liked to win a fight, you know, so my dad would tell those stories. You know, I'm like 5 years old, and I'm eating it up, you know, and he's like, come on, let's train. Left, right, hook. You know, and I'm like, I'm a lover, not a fighter, Dad. Let's make some peanut butter and jelly. He's like, no, we gotta train, you know. So school's hard, you gotta get ready, you know. I'm like, come on, mac and cheese with me, Dad. He's like, no, fight, you know. But here's the story of my dad's life. I would have been the next in line to receive all that anger and abuse. But my dad meets a beautiful woman, starts going to church because of her. It's not a good strategy that I'm endorsing, but I'm just saying it worked for them. And my dad decides, in sincerity and in reality, to give his life to Jesus. He realizes that his life's pretty messed up. If he doesn't have God step in, then he ain't going to go anywhere. And he really loved what would become my mother. He wanted to do things right. And gave his heart to Christ and started following after Jesus and stopped fighting and started serving God, and he started buying books about being a good dad before he was even had children. He bought books by a man named Dr. Dobson about how to raise godly kids, and he wanted to be a good dad. He wanted to stop the history that was so evil and bad for so long and start something new. And I want you to know tonight that I'm your pastor, because my dad made a decision to turn his life over to Jesus, start trying to be like him, as tough as that was to break out of that mold. But that's why I'm here. And I'm telling you that you go, man, I don't know if I can make a decision to do it right. I don't know. I'm telling you, any decision you make in your life at the bridge of your destiny, at the Jordan River, to go into the promised land and take on the good fight and quit living in the past and upset about what happened in Egypt, all mad about what you did to happen in the wilderness. Moses is dead. It's time for you to leave. And when you step into that, you say, I'm going to do what's right. And you go, I don't know if it's going to have an impact. I'm telling you, it has an impact. Forever, for the generations after you. I got two sisters. Both of them are serving Jesus today. I'm serving Jesus today. All the grandkids are serving Jesus today. That happened because one person made a decision to follow God in their life.
Yeah.
I'm telling you that God will take a follower and make them follow. I wanted to end with this thing I'm about to show you on the screen here in just a moment. And it's, don't judge me. I know it's Father's Day and I should be more manly. I tried to do the ammo box, but it's from an art blog. I even hate admitting that, but you know, I do it for Lisa, you know, art. I don't know, I like reading this kind of stuff. And it's an incredible story. I want you to see the first picture. This is kind of like our life. I was reading the story. We're like a little kid, and sometimes we can't see what God's doing in our life. We can't put all the pieces together. We're just living in the moment, trying to make it today. Let's go to the next picture. Sometimes we feel like this is our life. This is a real place in Egypt called Garbage City. There's no trash collection there. It's a real poor community. All the houses are painted the same, all the apartments. Everything looks devastating there. This is a real place, and this artist began to do this painting on some of the buildings, and I started reading this. I'm going, this is what God does in us. And look at this next painting. Sometimes we invite God to come into our life, and God begins to paint something beautiful, just a different color than what's next door to us. And it begins to change as we give him our life, and he begins to forgive us. And we still can't see what he's doing, but we go, something's different. And if you go to the next picture, you see maybe as you go through a little bit of life, maybe God's working in other people's lives too. He's going to connect you, put you next to some other people, but you still can't see all that God's doing. Go to the next picture. You begin to back out and you go, man, God's working in my city. And God's changing other people. And you just go, man, this is great. But even there, there's people you can't tell. But the next picture I'm about to show you, this was done by the intention of an artist who said, I want to do something beautiful in the most devastating place I know. And so he chose Garbage City and began to paint this mural. And you can't see it when you're in the city. You have to go outside the city, go up on the mountain, and look at what was painted. And if you go one more picture after that, this is what you see from the mountain. It's this perfect picture with this beautiful phrase on it. Man, in the moment, we don't know what God's doing in our lives, but he's painting something beautiful for you. And this is a beautiful thing. This art is actually, there's an ancient church, an underground church, because of persecution in Egypt called the Coptic. They're the Coptic Christians. And this is what this picture says. It says, anyone who wants, it's written in Coptic Christian symbolism. Anyone who wants to see the sunlight clearly needs to wipe his eye first. And I'm telling you, sometimes we've got to wipe our eyes and see clearly what God is doing. He's doing something beautiful in your life. He's out to do you good. He's out to change your destiny for you. He wants to help you. And the future is Father's. I'm going to ask my dad to come on stage with me for a moment. And Austin, I don't know if I think Abby's in her or she's in the kids' church, but many of my kids have to come up here. Would you guys come and join me? I was reading Seth Godin, who's a business guy writer. Somebody asked him this week in an article, they said, how do you change the world? And he said, you can't change the world, but you can change five people. He says, you pour yourself into those five people, and it'll change the world. The funny thing is, as I was reading that, I'm going, man, our email address in our house for a long time has been the bold five. And I'm like, man, come on, God's calling us to change our families. And you know, some of you are maybe listening to this message tonight. You go, I never had what you had, man. You had a great dad. That's good for you, but I never had that. And I'll never have that. But I want you to hear something tonight. You can have this. You can pour according to what you have right now. You can't go back. You don't have the blessing that I have, but you can be the blessing to the ones coming up behind you. You can make a good decision. You can follow Christ in your life and do what he says to do. And man, some of you maybe tonight need to make a personal commitment with a broken relationship to make a phone call, make an attempt again, to call, write a letter, maybe say I love you, maybe say thank you again, or maybe begin to pray with a fresh faith for your kids or your family members, and just know that, hey, I'm going to move forward, I'm going to lead well, I'm going to go after that. You guys can be seated. Thanks, love you guys. I want you to stand with me tonight. We're going to sing this song as a closing prayer, but I'm going to have my prayer teams at the front. And some of you just need somebody to join with you and pray with you. Maybe God wants to heal your broken heart tonight so you can forgive the Moseses of the past for whatever you did and did not have to go through. Maybe you just need somebody to pray with you, walk you through that. Maybe you've got to pray for God to just carry you through into the next season. I'm telling you, God's for you. He's with you. He cares about you. We're going to turn the lights down. A little bit of worship just one last time. But if you want prayer, come up and we're going to pray with you on this. But sing this out with all your heart tonight.